Hey, good evening, good evening. Praise the Lord for another day's journey. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. I will bless his name. Been a great day, a day that the Lord has ushered us into with his grace and his mercy. He's extended his grace and mercy upon us all the live long day. And it's such a wonderful opportunity for us to do what we desire to do most. Steady. We want to be a people that are approved of God, rightly dividing his word. Welcome this evening to this afternoon study. Facebook crowd, YouTube crowd, those who hunger and thirst, and I pray that you always hungry and thirst for the word of God in your life, for your life. We're so grateful for your attendance. We're so grateful for your desire to grow in grace and grow in mercy. We're going to get started as we have others come in with our hymn of encouragement. We need a word from the Lord. Hey, Trees, honey. Looks like Sister Walker. How you doing? Shan, honey, hey, good evening.
But what we need is a special word that will burn within our heart and give us direction from above. We need a word from the Lord, a word from the Lord, just one word from the Lord.
Yes, Lord. Lord, speak to us, dear Lord. Amen. Again, welcome to this evening's word study. Praise God for him getting us all through this day. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. Same God has been available to us day in and day out. And so we're so grateful and so thankful that he has extended his love, his compassion, his mercy to us. Welcome to each and every one of you. I pray that grace and that mercy and that your appreciation for him is solid, is strong. You're confident in him. That's what these lessons are designed to do. Let's pray. Father God, in the name of Jesus, bless you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless you, Lord, for your presence in all of our lives, Lord. Bless you, Lord, for out of your presence comes the sufficiency. Our needs are met. You know what we need. You know when we need more peace. You know when our joy is being impacted. You know when we need provision, Lord. Whatever it is we need, Lord, you are able and willing to provide. We thank you this day, Lord, for all of our sustenance. We thank you, Lord, for being our strength. We thank you, Lord, that you are forever pricking our consciousness, our hearts, Lord, and you forever making us aware of your holy and divine presence. Lord, we desire to be better. We desire to be stronger in our faith walk. And Lord, that's why we're assembled here. Maybe a few, Lord. But Lord, you say where two or three are gathered in your name, you will be in the midst. I know that you're in the midst, Lord. We're doing what you have commanded and you require us. Seek ye first. Study, Lord, to show ourselves approved. Workmen that need not be ashamed. And Lord, we don't want to be ashamed as we lift up your holiness, as we speak out, as we stand in these last and evil days. I bless you for every listener. I bless you for every participant. I bless you for every hearer. I bless you, Lord, that they use what you give them to be better, be stronger. And Lord, that they use what you've given them to inspire and encourage all who would want to hear. We want to be your spokesman, and we want to speak in an authorized way. In Jesus' name we bless you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 What are we looking at here tonight? We're continuing to equip ourselves so that we can combat the killer seeds of ministry, those elements that will destroy and make us ineffective witnesses for God's sake. What are those killer seeds? Compromise, going along to get along, complacency, getting to a place where you think you have arrived and you don't need to do anything more to grow. Contradiction, making sure that we are not contradicting and countering a word that God puts forth. God says, surely as my word goes forth. And we have issue today because God's word is being diluted and men's consciences are not being convicted and reached. Contradiction, what God says goes. Contention, fighting about things that oftentimes don't mean anything. God wants to be at peace with us and us to be at peace with one another. That's why we're doing what we're doing. I bless the Lord that you're searching. I bless the Lord that you're wanting to grow. And you are growing. We're going to be looking at Acts 19. We started it last week. We got to verse 7. Looks like we're going to pick up on verse 6 of verse 8 and try to get through verse 16. We should be able to do that. Committed to our time. Here a little, there a little. Not trying to inundate and to overwhelm us with the word. Just a little here, just a little there. And we take that and we meditate on it. Let it marinate within us, within ourselves. And Lord, and look for ways that we can improve our own lives so that we can help someone else improve their lives. Amen. God bless you. Scriptures. Beginning at verse 8, keep your Bible handy, whether you're on your tablet or whatever, or you got the word like me. I like both. I primarily like to use the written word, a Bible, but for the sake of, but for the convenience of this service, I use my tablet because I'm trying to look at you and I'm trying to keep an eye on that, making sure that we are staying together. Beginning Acts chapter 19, beginning at verse 8. We're going to look at verses 8 through 10. Last week, our first point of emphasis was ministry is ineffective without the Holy Spirit. God is compelling me to talk about his Holy Spirit at all times. It's the Holy Spirit that is making a difference in our lives. It is the Holy Spirit that is helping us to be transformed into the new creation that God has raised us up to be. We're learning how to love better. We're learning how to be patient. We're learning how to serve better in spirit and in truth. God is a spirit, and we have to be worshipers who operate within the confines of His Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is our comforter, He's our guide, He's our counselor, and He's going to remind us and bring to remembrance the things that we're talking about here on Tuesday night, the things that we read and learn about in our individual and private time, the things that we hear in a Sunday school session or in a worship session. I encourage you, I implore you, I beseech you, keep your word handy. And while God is speaking to you through the woeful mind of a wretch like me, He will give you the revelation that you need to be successful. Amen. So tonight, we're going to continue to talk about the Holy Spirit unction using us and teaching us and informing us of the way and the will of God through God's word. Starting at verse 8, the 8th part of verse 8 reads as follows. Then Paul went into the synagogue and spoke boldly there for 3 months, arguing persuasively about the kingdom of God. Speaking boldly for God comes from us doing what we're doing right now, comes from us spending time, our private time, in studying God's word. Study. What does it mean to study? It means that we go into something, seeking something. Look, I read most of the time. I like to read. I read most of the time just for enjoyment. I read when I'm reading a regular book. And I enjoy reading scripture. But when I read the scriptures, when I read God's word, I'm not just sitting down and just trying to enjoy it like a good novel or something, trying to find my way to the end. I am listening to God communicate to me via His Spirit. And that's what all of us should be doing right now. We should be listening for the communicated word of God via His Holy Spirit. If we are not, we are not going to be effective at witnessing. So here's Paul doing what is customary. We found out and we've discovered that this man, Paul, was very much so serious about his work and his activity for the Lord. Paul, like us, you know, we've come out of something. God has delivered us all from something. He's forgiven us, and it's this great privilege ought to burn within us as we spend time in His word, as we get opportunity to communicate His word, communicate His will, communicate His ways in our activity, in our conversation, spoken or visual. And that's what we're striving to do. That's why we're reading and studying God's word, because we want to know that what we're doing is that which God has established us to do. All of us have a purpose. Our primary purpose is to work the will of God. We work it in different ways. We're not gifted the same, but our ultimate aim is that we communicate the goodness of God. We communicate the grace of God. We communicate the power of God to all who would listen. And we don't just communicate this by saying, by talking about it. Our hearts and our minds have to be in concert with our mouths and our actions and our deeds have to reflect this burning desire that we have to communicate to a world that needs Him, that God is real, God is able, and He's just waiting for us to come to Him with all our heart, all our mind, all our soul, and all our strength. And so Paul is doing what is customary. Well, you and I need to have some habits, some Holy Ghost-filled, Holy Ghost-led habits, praying, worshiping, praising, studying, witnessing. Paul, wherever he was, he always found a church. And I encourage you, even in this day and age of pandemic, pestilence in the land, the safest place to be is in God's house. The safest company to keep nowadays is God. And so we've got to be confident, and we've got to be convicted, and we've got to be diligent and faithful at doing what God requires of us. Paul did this. Everywhere he went, he found a church. And he went in and he spoke boldly. You can speak boldly in the name of Jesus. You can speak boldly the word of God if you're doing what we're doing now. You don't have to be the best orator. You don't have to be the most gifted speaker. You don't have to be the most knowledgeable person in the room. You simply have to avail yourself, and God's Holy Spirit will just flow through you. I never could have imagined myself when I was growing up doing what I do now. And I don't do it because I'm the most intellectual. I don't do it because I'm the most gifted among speakers. I'm able to do it because God is at work in me, using a worm like me, using a wretch like me. And I declare myself to be a worm. I declare myself to be a wretch. But God says your righteousness is like filthy rags. So I can't establish myself as a bastion of righteousness. I'm so grateful to have this privilege to spend time right now with you doing what we're doing. And you should feel that way too. I declare boldly, and I'll say it every opportunity I get, I'm saved and I know it. I'm saved and I know it, even though I declare myself to be a wretch and a worm, because God has lifted me up from the dregs of my sin. And I live daily, day in and day out, trying to be a better person. This word that we're studying helps us to be a better person. We don't have to talk it. We just simply have to walk it. And folk will know. People will see. There are those who will not give you credit for anything. But God substantiates who you are. David, a man, he said, after his own heart. And I truly believe that God says the same about me. And you can believe that he says the same about you. David wanted what God wanted. I want what God wanted. You want what God wanted. And when we're doing that, we're men and women who are after. We pursue him. We want to exemplify who he is in our lives. Paul was devoted to doing this. And wherever he went into the church and he spoke. In the context, point of emphasis number two, Holy Ghost inspired preaching, and the Holy Ghost will do the reaching. You and I will not convert a soul. Don't put that burden on you. Don't put that pressure on yourself. The only thing we need to do is to be saturated with God's word. Become knowledgeable, become confident, become convicted, and become those people who simply go out there. God provides the moment. God provides the opportunity. All we need to do is just show up. You say, well, when is that? You never know. The Spirit lists where it wills. The Holy Ghost takes us where the Holy Ghost wants us to go to. And when you find yourself in what seems like an inopportune moment, you don't have any expectations of doing it. You just know that you're a witness because you've been studying, and we've been studying Jesus Christ. Every message is Jesus Christ. Every report is Jesus Christ. Every declaration is Jesus the Christ. Jesus told Peter, when Peter acknowledged who he was, and you and I have acknowledged, if we are saved and we know we're saved, it's because we've acknowledged Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Jesus told Peter, he said, when Peter confessed who he was, Jesus said, flesh and blood didn't tell you that. Peter, you didn't learn that from Moses. You read Moses. Peter, you didn't learn that from Daniel. You read Daniel. Peter, you didn't learn that from Isaiah or Jeremiah. Peter, you learned that because God, via his Holy Spirit, brought that revelation into your life. You and I simply have to be vessels that speak a word of life. And it is God that will bring the increase into someone else's life. Paul readily did this. Paul boldly did this. And you and I, doing what we're doing right now, and we follow after his example. He went to the church and he spoke boldly. The Bible says, in verse 8, it also says he argued persuasively. When you argue persuasively, first of all, arguing doesn't mean he was being contentious. It doesn't mean he was in a dogfight with somebody else. You believe this, I believe this. He simply spoke God's word. And it is God's word that persuaded the people. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, talk Jesus. Preach Jesus. Speak Jesus. Paul said, I preach Jesus Christ, him crucified. Him crucified is the reason that we can say we know we're saved. That's all we need to say. Jesus said, if I be lifted up, I'll draw. Lift him up in your life. Lift him up in your talk. Lift him up in your walk. Elevate Jesus Christ in such a way, in a compelling way, a believable way, a faithful way. And the Holy Ghost will reach out and grab somebody who's been providentially positioned to hear you witness on behalf of God, on behalf of Jesus Christ. And when we do that, it may seem like you're not reaching people. Just talk. Just talk. Because it's not your goal to reach. It's our goal to preach. And it is the job of the Holy Spirit to rein them in to Jesus Christ. That revelation, when Jesus asked Paul, he said, Paul, it's hard for you to kick against the pricks. The Holy Ghost was working on Paul. And Paul submitted. I submit it. All who have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, you've submitted. And so Paul went about persuasively talking about the kingdom of God. 9, but when some of them stubbornly refused to believe and publicly maligned the way, Paul took his disciples and left the synagogue to conduct daily discussions in the lecture hall of Tyrannus. This continued for 2 years so that everyone who lived in the province of Asia, Jews and Greek alike, heard the word of the Lord. No one is going to be able to say, Lord, I didn't hear the word. God has an appointed hour. God has appointed time. He's coming back like a thief in the night. And we don't want to be caught unawares. Since we know that his time is appointed, since we know that his timing is, his time is established. How is it that you and I ought to be conducting ourselves? How should we be living? What should we be doing? Jude tells us, you know, we got to be careful, but he said we preach and teach because it's like we're snatching some from the fire. Hell is a real place, and somebody's going to go to hell. Let it not be said that someone found themselves in hell because you and I were not bold in our witness. You and I were negligent. You and I sat down on our gifts. We're no better than the ones that we're supposed to be witnessing to when we sit down on our gifts. And so Paul went in. Everybody, some folks got to be contentious. They moved from debating and hearing to getting contentious to where, hey, they want to fight. Paul said, look, I don't have to stay here. God has given us the commandment that if we enter into a house and the spirit, our spirit rests in that house, stay there. But if our spirit returns to us, this is what Paul was experiencing. He went into the church, he was witnessing and he was preaching the acceptable day of the Lord. He was talking Christ, he was walking Christ, he was demonstrating Christ, his conviction in Christ, and the people became contentious, and the people, look, they got to a place where they were hostile. And then Paul exercised the word of God in his life. And this is where you and I got to learn these things. God did not establish us to beat somebody down. He didn't establish us that we grabbed his word and started hammering somebody upside the head. He put the word in us. It's in our hearts. And we simply speak from a confident and convicting way. People will receive it or they won't receive it. And God says, your spirit is being troubled. It's coming back to you because they're not rejecting you. They're rejecting me. It's time to move. And Paul moved. And we'll know when to move. When you are sincere and serious about being a witness for God, he'll tell you when you're in a situation where there's not going to be any turning. No heart's going to be changed. Jesus experienced this. He went to his own hometown in Galilee. Folk who he knew him refused to accept his testimony, particularly about himself. They started to say things like, wait a minute, isn't he from here? Folks said things, can anything good come out of Galilee? I don't know where you're from. I know where I'm from, over in the Mississippi Delta, and folks don't think highly of people from the Mississippi Delta. But you got to know you've been called and you've been positioned by God. God has not put the burden of us, our having to change people's hearts. He does that. We simply have to speak, and we simply have to know when to move. And we don't move because we become uncomfortable. We don't move because people become hostile. We move because the Holy Spirit says, God is not being received here. Get up, walk away, and wipe the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. And so we simply do what God says. And don't put that burden expectation on yourself. Paul kept on preaching. Look, God's always going to find present you with an opportunity. He left there, went to another place that God had already established. We don't get to any place because we say, oh, this is a good place. The Holy Spirit says, come on, sit down right here. This is where I want you to work and continue to work. And Paul did just this. And he stayed there for 2 years. He had daily discussion. Look, you and I may not be in the church on a daily basis. I am pretty much on a daily basis. You may not be, but look, everywhere we are, the church is. The building. I'm not talking about the building. When I say I am on a daily basis, I'm in the building, but I take the church wherever I go. You take the church wherever you go, and you can be a witness, a bona fide, credible witness for the Lord, any place that he takes you. And so they did that, and he kept talking about the Lord, and people heard the word. Notice in verse 10, it said, continued for 2 years so that everyone who lived in that area, Jews and Greek alike, heard the word of the Lord. It did not say that everyone was moved by that word. We just got to make sure that everybody hears it. And that's why we're studying, that we may be equipped to rightly divide the word of truth, workmen who need not be ashamed. When you know the word of God, and you don't have to be some theocratic scholar to know the word of God, you may not be able, I can't remember it word for word. I have to go search. I know it's there. But if you ask me what book and what particular verse, most of the time I won't be able to tell you. I can go find it. That's not a gift that God gives everybody. But when you know it's there, your heart will burn. And then you speak boldly. And you speak proudly. And you speak with great privilege the word that God has given you into your life and somebody else's. Okay, so bold preaching is going to help to reach people. Persuasive preaching. Persuasive means, it doesn't mean you're going to persuade somebody. It means that people see in you the credibility of that which you preach and that which you teach. Your testimony. People know when you're just sounding off. It's like what God said. These people serve me with their lips, but their hearts. And when your heart is in it, people are going to be able to tell. When you're genuine and sincere in your faith walk, people are going to know. Even those who have aligned themselves against you and who may take an occasion to rail against you, they know you're sincere. They don't want to admit it, but they know you're a different creature. Particularly those folks who know you from way back. I remember when. Yeah, I remember when too. But I'm a changed man. That's your testimony. I'm saved. And being saved means that you're not the same person that you used to be. Okay, a point of emphasis number 3. We're going to finish up tonight. Holy Spirit-powered witnesses and workers. We can't accomplish anything for God if we're not doing it via his Holy Spirit. Beginning at verse 11 through 16, God did extraordinary miracles through the hands of Paul. Paul didn't do it. God did it. So that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick, and the diseases and evil spirits left them. This is one of the things where, you know, we don't see such manifestation the way they ought to be. Now, for Jesus would tell us it is a matter of faith. Faith, the size of a mustard seed, can move a mountain, which is why God is talking to me more about talking to us about exercising the power that's available to us via the Holy Spirit. When Jesus sent his disciples out 2 by 2, he gave them power to cast out demons. He gave them power to drink deadly drink. He gave them power to cast out demons, power to change people's lives. And this is what Paul was doing. But Paul didn't do it of himself. Paul had to be humbled because he began to boast about him being able to do these things. And God will do that to us. He will humble us when we fail to recognize, fail to report that when something happens and we're nothing but the vessels and we try to take credit for it, he will humble us. He will give us a thorn in our flesh. Because Paul believed, because Paul was genuine, God was able to do miraculous things through him. Now, are we all going to be able to do those things? We can. Is that an expectation of God? That is something where Paul talks about how we ought to have been moved from elementary truths. Talking about Jesus being born, talking about Jesus dying, and talking about Jesus being resurrected from the dead isn't enough. That's an elementary truth. It's powerful. And it's that confession, the confession of such, wherein we are saved, and that's our testimony, our conviction, our belief, our certainty, our assurance. But Paul said we need to have graduated from milk to being meat eaters. And this is what God is telling us about. When we use his Holy Spirit, we can become licensed workers for him versus unlicensed. We get this done and close it out. Now, 13 says, now there were some Jews, some itinerant Jewish exorcists who tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those with evil spirits. They would say, I bind you by Jesus whom Paul proclaims. Seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. Now here it is. These were unlicensed workers. They were trying to preach and use the name of Jesus Christ, and they didn't have any relationship with him. Unlicensed. And as a result, the demon said, Paul, I know, Jesus, I know, but who are you? And when we try to move in our own flesh, that's why we got to work in the Holy Spirit. When we try to move in our own conventional way, the enemy that we're trying to speak against, because we have no relationship with Jesus Christ, has power over us versus our being having power over them. You don't get power, the power of Jesus Christ, by associating with him in name only. You got power. We get power from Jesus Christ by believing and confessing him as Lord and Savior, all powerful, all knowing, and all present. And because these were unlicensed workers trying to make a living for themselves and offer themselves, and without having a relationship with Christ. The opposite of the licensing of Paul, who was able to do these things, who was able to perform miracles, because he had a right relationship with Jesus Christ. When our relationship with Jesus Christ is right, he says we can say move mountain, and mountains will move. Holy Spirit, gotta have him at work in our lives. And because of such, 15 say, eventually one of the evil spirit answered them, Jesus, I know, said that. Paul, I know about, but who are you? And then they attacked those who tried to exorcise and remove them without having any power. This became known to all the Jews, 17, and the Greeks living in Ephesus. No, I said we were going to stop at 16, didn't I? Yeah, we're going to stop there. We're going to stop there. What have we been talking about in a nutshell? Operating in the Holy Spirit. Having a customary habit of doing so. Believing and trusting Jesus Christ. That if we simply open our mouths and witness him and lift him up, he's going to be the draw. He's going to be the attraction. It's just like, you know, when you go fishing. You got to have a lure. And look, fish are not going to eat everything you throw at them. And the church cannot be a church that's in compromise and trying to throw worldly stuff at people. Look, if I want worldliness, I can go back out in the world. But we want Christ. And we go through his word to get it. Amen. God bless you. God love you. Thank you for your attendance on tonight. I thank you for your devotion and commitment to hearing the word of God. And I pray that as you've listened to me, as you listen to anyone who's teaching that word, you're following along, and the Holy Spirit will bear witness to all of us that God is speaking to us. Amen. God bless you. God loves you. I bless you in the name of Jesus, and I love you too. Have a great night.